go ahead and get started, I see some people are still filing in. There's some open seats closer to the front, front row wide. And there's a few that are kind of in the middle of various rows. My name is Travis Heavy, and I was a graduate of the Computer Science Engineering program here in 1995. I'm imagining that that's probably actually maybe before a few of you were born. A subset of Google Cloud. Google Cloud has over 100, I think, different products. But here we're going to go over just the ones that are most relevant to a setting like this, where you have to get something working quickly and you have a limited time to do it. All right. So, we're going to talk about App Engine, what that might be used for, and machine learning APIs, and then we're going to follow up by talking about Cloudflare. And then in the opening, we talked about the API challenge for Cloudflare, just for more information about that. So Cloud, it's a dictionary definition, getting stuff done with other people's computers, right? Right? Maybe not. But seriously, what is it? It's what you use to build the server side of kind of really any application these days. Unless it's just a little self-contained game that doesn't really do much. If it's something that's going to interact with the real world, then having some sort of central component is key. To build that yourself, that's going to get awfully expensive, awfully quickly. I believe the latest publicly announced figures of what Google spends on its data centers is, I think, what is it, $30 billion per year? You do not want to be writing a check for that much. All right, so this is what a data center looks like. This one is in Council Bluffs, Iowa, one of our large ones. They are very secretive. What they show. There are a few photos that are approved for public consumption. And this kind of gives you a sense of the scale of these kind of operations. They are really, really huge. All right, so here are just a few of the Google Cloud products. As you can see, it's a pretty big list. Kind of freeze and just say, I don't know what to do, or you can look at the TLDR version. All right, so these are the things that maybe students might be able to make use of. So here we're going to cover App Engine, we're going to cover machine learning APIs, and then Firestore. There were two others that we're not going to talk about much, but I think that they are pretty relevant. And that is Cloud Functions and BigQuery. I'll just give a one-sentence description of each. Cloud Functions, that's for automation, like whenever you want to do it, like an if-this-then-that operation. You can observe something and then it will kick off the process. And then BigQuery is our solution for big data analysis. So this, you can operate over very large data sets. When I say large, I do mean very large, like petabytes. It can work for that. Probably won't be given petabytes this weekend. Maybe some will. Okay. App Engine. It's a jet engine that's not very airworthy. This is what you use to deploy web backends and also mobile backends. A form of what we call serverless computing. Serverless computing doesn't mean that there's no server. It just means that you don't have to worry about it. Right? You just write the code that happens when somebody connects to a particular URL with a particular formatted request. And then you process that request and then get data back, data in, data back, data out. And then in the meantime, to other places. the thing that sets this framework apart is that it does not need to worry about like the scaling. So you just write the kernel that happens when you get a request, and then you let App Engine take care of like mapping more and more instances to it. And so that can make things a lot easier. Okay, so this is what you might see referred to in the industry as platform as a service. So PaaS. Okay. Here, you just focus on your code, and you don't have to worry about the actual job. So here we would dive into a Flask app like Hello World, and let's see if I can actually make it. No guarantees. But so here is what this is the quick start, and then you can download the SDK locally, or what you can do is just go to console.com. And then, because I'm internal, it redirects to something else. It will look very much the same to you. And you go to App Engine. And in there, if you are a new user, it'll show you a demo of. Not demo, but it'll be a tutorial that leads you towards getting the app engine, the Hello World going. Okay. Okay. So, machine learning on Google Cloud. Who knows what machine learning is? What is machine learning? Allowing the computer to learn from data. All right, so dog or muffin, right? This is an internet meme that that everybody saw from a couple of years ago. But it's a lot harder to see when you have the failure cases. You can let Google Cloud handle this kind of classification for it. You send it an image, and it will send you back the things that are inside. It will tell you whether it's a puppy or not. I'm not actually sure how well it would do with these particular data sets. But if that's all you need, is to just get back particular labels of what might be in there, then that could be the computer vision APIs might be a good use for that. All right, natural language processing. So this allows you to pick out entities from a particular sense. You can see what things are being referenced, whether people are talking about you, whether somebody really needs to intervene from your support team, whether people are angry. So now, there's rules that are defined in English for how to set up a sentence, right? So these are complex rules, these are things that if you're a native speaker, you will know intuitively, but if you're a foreign speaker, you're going to struggle with. So it's quantity or number, quality or opinion, size, age, shape, color, and then the proper name. So why is it a quick brown fox instead of a brown quick fox? Right? Would you be able to reliably set up those kinds of rules in your programming environment to know which word to put first? So machine learning takes takes the rules and then also adds in the experience to create new rules. So with classical programming, you decide what all the rules are, and you need to anticipate all the possible cases. You have tests that show the data, but you need to code up all the possible things that your program can do. With machine learning, you just give it the data and the answers, and then it makes inferences and fits a model to those answers. And then it can generalize to data that it's never seen before. So machine learning is the study of algorithms that improve automatically through experience. Very, very close to the definition you gave. Okay? It's using data to answer questions. All right. So you go from data to model prediction. All right, so Google Photos. This is an example of machine learning applied at Google. I believe it recently passed 1 billion users. It's one of the 7 products that Google has that has hit that threshold. So you are able to search for dogs, right? But in addition, you're able to do things like search for dogs in Hawaii, right? It can give you a reasonable result. And then that all comes from just classifying, like throwing massive amounts of data. The Google Assistant is able to bring in multiple ways of machine learning. It does the speech to text. So it takes the sound waves and translates it into text that can be processed by machine. But then it also takes that text output and feeds that into general search, and that is all done with machine learning. Google Translate. When Translate first started, it was all done by trying to build up a model of the source language and the target language, and it went through kind of an intermediate layer, kind of similar to Esperanto. And it kind of sucked, actually. But then they figured out that just by throwing lots and lots of data at the problem, that they could get that they could get neural nets to do the same work much better. And the very first one that they did was French. The team on Google Brain was discouraged from looking at French because the French was so far developed. The English to French, that was the one that they had spent nearly, more than any other language, they had spent developing that. But the neural net just completely blew it out of the water. So after that, the Google Translate team was called into an all-hands meeting, and the vice president announced, "Everybody, stop what you're doing. We're going to change directions. You need to find other jobs." And the brain team took over. So the machine learning APIs gives you access to like some of that power, right? So there's 5 different APIs. Let's see if I can name them right. We have the vision API, the video intelligence API, speech to text, translate and natural language process. Got it, all 5. All right. So you can gain insights from your data just by using the pre-trained models from Google Cloud. All right. And you can use the same kind of technology, the same models from neural nets, like what the Google Assistant and Google Photos are doing. And so you don't have to have any prior knowledge of machine learning. Now, the only downside of this is that you're getting the standard model that's just kind of a generic model that is code to what people, what we expect people might want to get out of this. There's basically three levels that you can plug into machine learning at Google, and specifically on Google Cloud. Right, so machine learning APIs, which is probably the most appropriate for this kind of compressed time frame. It's where you just pass data into the pre-trained models, and you get the data out. Depending on which API it is, it'll be different inputs and different outputs. The fundamental thing here is that it's pre-trained models. Okay. The next one is AutoML. AutoML is where you give it a list of inputs, right, and the set of outputs that you want to match to those. And there, the training is specific to some sort of vertical. Like, for example, image classification. Like, this works great for like being able to tell whether what you're looking at is like a particular brand of cell phone that you want to identify, or whether it's a like the examples of flowers, right? You want to identify one particular flower, or say it's a pest, right? Suppose you want to identify some sort of weed in a crop field. This could be great for that. You don't have to code up the exact ways that the neural nets like hook back to each other. You don't have to deal with like the number of hidden layers or the base support for like when signals fire. Those kind of decisions are already tuned for the specific vertical that AutoML might work for, but you can, we'll get questions. But then you can, like, within that vertical, you can get a lot more customization. The final way that you can hook into machine learning is with TensorFlow, and that's where you take control of the entire process. TensorFlow is an open source project that started at Google, but now has become like one of the most popular open source projects ever. I mean, it's amazing how much attention it gets. It's really gotten a lot of mindshare among developers. And so it is, I think, the gold standard of what to do if you want to become like a machine learning practitioner, more than just dealing with data. Okay. And I jumped ahead, sorry. But these are the five APIs. Okay. Next, we go to Cloud Firestore. Cloud Firestore is, at its base, it's a database, right? But it's more than that. It is a real-time database, and it can serve as a synchronization point for basically whatever connected app you are trying to put together, like whether it's a web app or a mobile app or both. Like sometimes you'll have a website or an app view of the same data. Like when you go to your bank, the expectation these days is that the bank will have a way to interact with it both on the web and using a mobile app. Firestore can be that point. Okay. So it is a NoSQL real-time database. Okay, who knows what NoSQL means? Alright, you in the back.
Basically it means it's not only SQL and it's schemaless compared to the relational database.
So it's what?
NoSQL is not only SQL, which is no relational, it's schemaless database.
Schemaless, right, that's the key.
Right.
Right? So with an SQL database, you would have like a set of records that conform to some sort of shape, right? So like, I suppose you're dealing with student data, then you'll have things like name, first name, last name, date of birth, maybe their payment status, like whether they're late on their tuition or something like that. But the idea is that there will be a set of fields that are supposed to exist on every record. A NoSQL database, on the other hand, is just a free-for-all. It's just a set of objects, right? You can put student there, you can put brand, like the first name, brand of bicycle, favorite ice cream, say a pet's name, I don't know. And just every record might have a different set of information, and it'll be just keys and values for every piece of information, and with every record might be different. Okay? So you query a database for new updates. So you can, when records change, you can get that information very, very quickly. Right? And so you can also subscribe and get a notification. So these will come in as events. Right? And you do this by just setting up a listener. And how to set up listeners is going to be specific to the language with which you're interacting. Firestore has bindings for just about every language that you would want to use. So, the data model. So, it'll have the collections, and then records, and then keys, and data, documents, and collections. Right. The document would be the users, and the collection would be the particular entries there. So that would be the A Lovelace and Sally Bride. Okay. Now we're going to try a little game here. So can you, everybody, whip out your cell phone and go to this. Pack Davis Firestore demo. So, everybody guess what labels might have been put in this image. All right. Now, if we go to the dashboard and see what people are typing on. So, whatever you type in. Please don't take advantage. No red rolls, okay? you can see these are. Hey, what? All right. These are coming in real time. We'll go over questions at the end. My apologies for the off branding. I put this together for the last hackathon. It says .hack instead of hackdavis. Sorry. My apologies to the Hack Davis folks. sub-collections. So these collections can have sub-collections. So you can have basically a tree of objects that you change together to represent whatever level of hierarchy makes sense in your situation. If you're representing a company, then you can have the division and the department, and then the team, and then the individual employees, for example. But the hierarchy of how these records are organized is generally going to be domain specific. Okay. Cloud Firestore, it has like really easy query syntax where you just give it the key and the expectation of value, and then it will return back to you all the sets of records that match those particular specifications. Okay? All right. So what are some of the main advantages? So it scales really well. Relative to serving based on your own computer, it's going to be able to handle a lot more queries. So it replicates across multiple regions, so that if there is a disaster in one area, for example, a tsunami in Japan, it would be able to serve from other areas, and no data would be lost. The standard is to have three copies of everything. It has strong consistency. You know that if something is in the database, you have the most up-to-date version of it. And then it has client libraries for all sorts of different environments that might want. There may have even been others added since this list. Not 100% sure on that. Okay, so the API challenge for best use of Google Cloud, we're going to have first place is going to be these bad guys. They are really nice. You can come by here at the booth and see them. And then the second place are these Google Nest Minis. If you've ever used a Google Nest Mini, or they used to be called Google Home Minis, the ability to answer queries is actually pretty impressive. It's a lot smarter than Siri, I'll say that. And then inside an email that you got from MLH, there should be a coupon or a link in which it is embedded a code for $50 worth of cloud credits. So you can use it for free. So this was maybe a picture you want to take. There's some resources here that might be useful to you later. In particular, this second one on the list, this Ryan Matt's GCP hackathon demos. That's the source code, for example, for the our store demo that I gave. So if you want. Want to look up an entire store project, that would be a good place to start. It also has a README to show you how to import that into your own environment. There's a lot of useful stuff in there that is maybe otherwise a little bit hard to find. Okay. And if you need any help, we are here for you. So we have three Google engineers. As it happens, all of our CDMI. So we're all here to pay it forward, and we want to help you guys be successful in your journeys as you go from student to workers. So now it might be the time to cover whatever questions.
Yeah, I was just wondering if this is the case in the
Firestore
demo. Firestore demo.
Yeah, those are correct and incorrect.
Okay.
Yes. So there's no 420 in this image. any others? Yeah. Oh no, sorry. We have one. I'll get you next. So the question is, if you are doing machine learning and you want to change just a few of the hyperparameters, can you do that without going straight to TensorFlow? And I think the answer to that is no. That I think that as soon as you want to be tweaking hyperparameters, like the number of layers, that's when TensorFlow is appropriate. That being said, I think that there are probably starting points that have a working TensorFlow implementations that you can just tweak. So Firestore is a subset of Firebase. The Firestore is the part of Firebase that deals with storage. Right? Firebase gives you more than just storage. It also, one of the key things is it handles the authentication. There's a couple of other services that, it's a suite of like utilities that are really useful for putting together these interconnected apps. And Firestore is probably the most useful one of those. But I think there's a good chance that, depending on what you're doing, that the authentication could also be useful as well. Because that is a tough thing to get right. Any other questions? Alright, so we got swag. I did see one question in the very back there.
Yeah, so I don't have too much experience with databases, but what makes like a Firestore different from like the sort of SQL like Google?
I'm having trouble hearing you.
Oh sorry, So what makes like Firestore like different from SQL like Google? For using as a database? Yeah.
I think it's easier to get set up. It's a nice combination of being easy to set up and also still being scalable. One downside of it being a NoSQL database is that you don't have type safety. So if there is errors on the data that you're importing, if you're trying to get everyone's last names, right? But maybe 10% of them, instead of last names, they have last nams, right? Then you just miss a whole bunch of data, right? And it would happily take that, and it would just miss the queries. If I could get my coworkers and then also is Akshay in here? Yeah, can you come up over by the swag? If you guys don't want swag, if you guys don't want t-shirts or that, you guys are free to go and just catch up with us individually on the booth. But if you do, we're probably not going to have quite enough for everybody. So I came up with an ingenious way of deciding who gets to do it. What I'd like everybody to do is, with one hand, hold up a random number between 1 and 5. Right? All right. Everybody can see, so that everybody can see it, right? No closed fists. All right. And so we're going to line up and... five first. So fives go to the front. Okay. Fives get to go to the front. Just line up along the back. You guys get first pick. All right. Next, we're gonna get ones. Ones get to go next. All right. All right.